Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening and welcome to Oscar J. Peterson Planetarium's History Series. I am Susie Aber, the director of the Science and Math Education Center and Peterson Planetarium at Emporia State University. My students and I have been providing free custom presentations of the history of space exploration nearly every Thursday since January of 2015. So we began with manned missions, Mercury, Gemini, Apollo, in part because they were the focus of the 1961 speech by President Kennedy, who put out the challenge that we should go to the moon, land, and return safely to Earth by the end of the decade. So, mission accomplished, July 1969, it happened. But that success would never have been as it was without the other side of the story, and that is NASA had a parallel projects going on with unmanned space exploration. And so in August, we switched our focus to unmanned space exploration, and that is the topic of our talk tonight from our special speaker. NASA and her sister global partners have a new vision, and that vision is manned journey to Mars. So there's a lot of interest in Mars, and potentially just over a decade from now. The overall process starts with technology and exploration and science. Our special speaker tonight, Phil Knocke, was a Mars mission engineer who specifically worked on the technology that gave us a clear window to explore the red planet and to further our scientific understanding of Mars. Phil grew up in the Southwest U.S. in a military family. He did a mechanical engineering undergraduate degree at Rice University in Houston. He went on to do a master's at Stanford and then went back to Texas and at UT Austin did a doctorate in aerospace engineering. He was in internships and he was working with the NASA Johnson Space Agency, NASA Ames, NASA Goddard. You see a pattern here. He was in DC at the NASA headquarters, and for 15 years he worked at JPL, NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab in Pasadena, California. So he's worked on advanced studies and projects that include the Galileo probe, Mars sample return concepts, the Comet Rendezvous asteroid flyby, Cassini-Saturn, and Mars 98. Specifically, he served as the approach, entry, and descent mission engineer and worked with the navigation teams on the Mars exploration rovers, my two favorite Martians, the little robotic geologists that had a lot of help from their friends on Earth, Spirit and Opportunity. Phil is retired from JPL. He moved to Missouri with his wife, his son, and the family dog. He is active in the Missouri Master Naturalist Program, and he also continues his favorite hobbies, which includes juggling and chip carving. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Phil Knocke.
Well, thank you. Thank you for being here tonight, and thank you to Dr. Aber for inviting me. Can you hear me in the back?
Yeah.
Been good? Okay. At JPL, I was in what they call the mission design section, which basically involved issues associated with trajectories, how to get from one planet to another, what to do once you get there, what kind of orbit to get into, if you wanted to do a flyby or a landing. And so my and the implications of those trajectories. One nice thing about that sort of job is that it allowed me to be involved in the mission from the very early stages, from planning all the way through to development and finally to flight operations. For the Mars Exploration Rover project, I was, as Dr. Avery said, given the title of Approach, Entry, and Descent Mission Engineer. I'll be talking more about what that meant and the phase associated with it, but basically it was associated with the 6 minutes of terror that occurred between from the top of the atmosphere of Mars down to the surface and landing. I usually include a slide like this at the end, but I'm putting it up at the very beginning here to remind everyone that, as far as I'm concerned, these are human missions to Mars. We call them robotic missions, but frankly, those robots, the rovers, would be just so much abstract art if it weren't for the human beings that stood behind them. Every bolt, every nut, every decision made, and every centimeter those rovers rode were because of the human beings that developed them and worked to operate them. I also want to thank the people who stood behind the people who stood behind the robots, the family and friends who had to endure long nights and frustrated spouses. This is a picture of my wife, Melanie, and my son, Charlie. This was in 2004, just before the, I mean, 2003 or 2004, just before the rovers were packed up and sent to the Cape for launch. So it must have been 2003, because they landed in January 2004. Okay, this is a size comparison of Earth and Mars. Okay, Mars' diameter is about half that of the Earth. It's in some respects similar to Earth. It has an axial tilt that is quite similar to the Earth's, and it has a rotation rate that is almost the same. It's about 40 minutes longer, I believe. There the similarities end. Mars is a very forbidding sort of environment. It's very dry. There's no liquid water on the surface. And it's very cold. At summer, at the equator, the temperatures could get up to 70 degrees Fahrenheit. But that very night, it would plummet to 100 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. And at the poles, we're talking about 200 degrees below zero. So it's an extremely cold place. Part of it's because it's getting about half the solar energy that we get at Earth, because it's farther out. But the main reason is the atmosphere is very thin. Its density is about 1% that of the Earth. And so there's just nothing to keep any heat in. So this is the way we see Mars today. The entire planet is one big ozone hole. The surface is bombarded by ultraviolet radiation. It's dry, drier than any place on Earth, even the dry Antarctic valleys. And it's, of course, extremely cold. There's no liquid water on the surface anywhere. But at one time in the past, maybe in the extreme distance, the distant past of Mars, it might have been quite different. What we have here are pictures from a variety of orbiters. I mean, ever since we sent orbiters to Mars and finally got a close-up look at Mars, we were seeing features like this. This picture was from the Mariner 9 spacecraft, which orbited Mars. It was the first spacecraft to orbit another planet, and it did so in the 1970s. And as you can see, what you have here looks very much like a river with tributaries. Same thing here. And this, to me, is a remarkable picture. It's a picture of streamlined islands, okay, like what you'd find in the middle of the Missouri River. And similar structures here. So the evidence seemed to be that there was at one time water on Mars, and perhaps a lot of water, creating catastrophic carbon of the surface. Just a few years ago, Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter discovered these linear lines, which actually flowed downhill. And what this is, or the interpretation is, that this is extremely briny water that lowers the freezing point of the water, and that just below the surface, this water actually is flowing downhill. And that was just discovered a year or two ago. So the question of water on Mars is a very interesting one. All of this seems to indicate that at one time in the past, Mars might not have looked like this, but might have had a much warmer and much wetter environment. There is even the possibility of an ocean at Mars, and it probably would have been in the northern hemisphere, as shown here, because that's lower elevation. There's still a lot of work that has to be done and a lot of head scratching associated with how you can develop an environment like this. And then, of course, there's a question of where did water go? Actually, one question is, where did Mars get all its water? And that is a question that's common to the Earth, because we don't know where we got all the water that's in our oceans. One possibility is due to bombardments by comets and asteroids. So the same might be true in that case of Mars, but for Mars the question is, if at one time there was a thicker atmosphere that allowed the heat to be captured, the atmosphere was probably still carbon dioxide like it is today, nothing you'd want to breathe. But what happened to the atmosphere? Did it get lost to space? What happened to the water? Is it bound up in the soil? Is it underneath the surface in reservoirs? So the question of water on Mars is a very interesting one because, as many of you know, water is necessary, especially liquid water, is important to the existence of life. So for the past 20 years or so, NASA has been, as it said, following the water. It's trying to understand the history of hydrology on Mars. And I want to, since this is a historical presentation, I want to talk a little bit about the history of successful Mars landings. And it's a pretty short presentation because there have only been 7 or 8, depending on how you measure success. In 1971, the Soviet Union sent Mars 3, among others, to land on Mars. And it did land. But it only sent back about 20 seconds of a signal, which was supposed to be a picture, but there was no useful data in it. So you could say that it landed successfully, but it didn't really improve our knowledge of Mars. Interestingly enough, it had a tiny rover. And this is something I just discovered recently. It had a little tethered rover called the Prop M that kind of would chug along on the surface. So. You know, mobility on the surface was something that was anticipated from the very beginning. In 1976, what I consider one of the greatest planetary exploration missions, the Viking project, landed 2 Viking landers on Mars. There were 2 launches from Earth during the same opportunity. Aboard each launch vehicle was a mated orbiter and lander, which went into orbit together. The orbiters were used to take pictures of the surface and help the mission controllers decide where to land the landers. The landers then separated from the orbiters and deployed from orbit, landing propulsively on the surface. This was an amazing mission. It included life detection experiments, meteorology, seismology, composition experiments. It was an extraordinary mission, and it was done 40 years ago. The landers themselves operated for more than 3.5 and more than 6 years on the surface and contributed greatly to our knowledge of what Mars was like on the surface. And the orbiters also orbited Mars for many years. Then there was a hiatus of more than 20 years before the next landing on Mars. And that mission was quite different. In 1997, Pathfinder landed successfully on Mars. And as its name suggested, it was primarily an engineering demonstration mission with a science payload. The idea here was rather than using a propulsive landing like Viking, they wanted to demonstrate a more robust, possibly more reliable, and less expensive way of getting payloads down to the surface of Mars. The way this worked is, as the vehicle approached, it would have, the vehicle was encased in a capsule which contained a heat shield and back shell, just like Viking, or similar in concept to Viking. Then a parachute would deploy, like Viking. The heat shield would drop off, and from the inside of the back shell, a capsule would be lowered on a bridle, and airbags would be inflated around that capsule. Solid rockets, very simple solid rockets, would be used to slow the vehicle some more. The bridle would be cut, and the airbags would bounce and roll along the eventually being retracted and the capsule opening up to reveal the science payload. For Pathfinder, there was a stationary portion, and then it also had on one of the pedals a small rover. So this was the first successful rover on Mars. It was called Sojourner, weighed about 25 pounds, and it was about the size of a microwave oven. It had a single instrument on it, an alpha particle X-ray spectrometer for doing geology. The next missions were in 2004, and this is what I will eventually be talking about. Mars exploration rovers, much larger, and they landed successfully on opposite sides of Mars in January of 2004. The design lifetime for Pathfinder was essentially 30 days, and it lasted much longer than that. The design lifetime for the Mars rovers was 90 sols, that is, Martian days. And as you can see, they well exceeded expectations. Spirit operated for more than 7 years, and incredibly, Opportunity is still operating after 13 years on Mars. I never would have thought that my son would go into high school and, you know, with the possibility of one of these rovers still operating on Mars. In 2008, the Phoenix stationary lander landed propulsively near the North Pole of Mars. And it operated for 5 months. And in 2012, the extraordinary Curiosity rover landed almost a ton of rover on Mars, and it's currently in its very successful surface mission. I like this picture here because it kind of shows the evolution of the Mars rovers. They have a lot of things in common. They all have the six-wheeled rocket motor, a very successful way of moving something across uneven terrain. As a matter of fact, I'm sure Curiosity could roll over these seats without any trouble. So Spirit and Opportunity were about as tall as a human being. Curiosity, more like the size of a small SUV. Now, as far as what brought the Mars Exploration Rover project into existence, it was affected as much by the missions that didn't work as the ones that did. I also worked on the Mars Surveyor 98 project, which was going to deliver an orbiter and a lander. Mars Polar Lander was supposed to land near the South Pole of Mars, because that's how the interplanetary geometry the interplanetary geometry allowed that during this opportunity. Unfortunately, Mars Climate Orbiter failed to achieve orbit. What happened was there was a miscommunication between the spacecraft team and the navigation team, and it left led to a rather disastrous error in the navigation state as we approached the planet. Mars Polar Lander also crashed on landing, and that was a software error. There was what we believe happened is that the thrusters fired, but then were cut off prematurely, and it wound up crashing. So NASA had to reevaluate its Mars program at this point. There had just been two significant failures, excruciating failures, I can tell you. And so the question is, what to do next? Well, in the pipe was Mars Surveyor 2001, which was going to be, in a lot of ways, similar to Mars 98. It had an orbiter, and it had a lander with a very similar design to Mars Polar Lander. And this would have included a small rover. Well, basically, NASA decided to continue with the orbiter. This eventually became Mars Odyssey. The lander was canceled, although the lander itself was kind of placed on the shelf and later refurbished and used for the successful Mars Phoenix mission. And fortunately for us, there were a lot of instruments which had been developed for the rover. So, what came out of this was the Mars Exploration Rover Project. And the idea was to put a robotic field geologist on Mars. Obviously, if we want to know what happened in the distant past at Mars, we have to look at the same things we look at on Earth, the geology. It's the only thing that survives. And so we want a robotic field geologist to do the same sort of things that a geologist would do on Earth. Geologists would go somewhere of interest, you'd look around, understand the lay of the land. You might go over and pick up a rock, break it open with a geologist's hammer, and look at the inside with a hand lens. And so we wanted our field geologists to be able to do the same thing. So MER had a panoramic camera at the top of a deployable mast. It also had an infrared spectrometer that would allow it to take a look at the heat signatures of rocks and help you determine the composition. So it's like, if you continue this analogy, the field geologist would have to have, you know, superpowers. It also had nav cameras to so that we could plan its movements. It had a variety of antennas for communicating to the Earth and also communicating to two orbiters in orbit around Mars at that time, Mars Global Survey and Odyssey. It was powered by solar panels, and it would have hazard cameras in the front and in the back. Once again, the famous rocker bogey suspension, and in the front, a robotic arm, at the end of which were a variety of instruments. Mars Spiral Spectrometer, Alpha Particle X-ray Spectrometer, which has always flown on all of our rovers. These help to determine the composition of rocks. And then a rock abrasion tool and a microscopic imager. And what the rock abrasion tool, or RAT as it was called, would do is grind down the surface, get beyond that desert varnish, and microscopic imager would take a look at it under magnification. This is a brief video that will give you an idea of what the project looked like. I mean, the sequence of events, I should say. Obviously, we start with the Delta launch.
3, 2, 1.
Is of course very much compressed. First stage is dropped off, second stage fires. Fairing drops off and reveals the spacecraft and its crew stage. Third stage is then spun up for stability. Third stage fires, and you're on your way to Mars. They use use conservation of angular momentum to slow down the spin, and now we're ready to go. The capsule is in there, and in the back is a cruise stage which has solar panels, maneuvering jets, and communications equipment. It's only used during cruise. So 7 months later, we come screaming into interplanetary space, drop off the cruise stage. And obviously now we're using the heat shield to protect us from the heat pulse. The next event is deployment of the parachute, which is deployed at supersonic speeds. Drop off the heat shield, and by the way, make sure it doesn't fly back and smash into us again. And now the lander is dropped down on the bridle. Airbags inflate. A radar altimeter detects when the time is for the rockets to fire. The bridle is cut. And you have a bounce and roll. And this bounce and roll can last for a while and can cover, you know, half a mile at least. The airbags are then deflated and retracted, revealing a tetrahedron, which no matter how it lands, when it opens up, it will land up on its base pedal. There's our rover, opening the solar panels, and actually everything that you see here takes several days to occur, all of these deployments. And now the rover stands up and is ready to roll off of the capsule and start its surface mission. Here's a close-up of the cameras on the pan cam. The landing site didn't look anything like this. You know, they always have to put in cliffs. And off we go. One thing I don't like about this animation is that the rover isn't really going that fast. Rovers go extremely slowly. It's a good way to avoid bumping into a rock or falling off a cliff. And besides, it's more energy saving. And now they've decided there's a rock they want to take a closer look at. Rolls up to it and deploys the robotic arm, at the end of which is the rat, which then just grinds down the surface, and the microscopic imager is deployed to take a look. So that gives you an idea of what the mission concept was. So the Mars Exploration Rover project was approved in August 2000, less than 3 years from launch. This is a very short time for developing something as ambitious as this project is. And in addition, the other shoe that fell from NASA headquarters was, we're going to land two rovers in that same opportunity, and we're going to use the Pathfinder system. The idea was the Pathfinder system was going to be more reliable than the propulsive landing system that was used for Mars Surveyor 98. That is a debatable point. You could argue that we've landed, at this point, we've landed propulsively on Mars twice with airbags once. But this was the direction, and so this was our goal. So one challenge is doing two launches in one opportunity. I'm not going to go over this in detail, But what this shows is one of the tools that we use for coming up with the launch periods for these two spacecraft. Along this axis is launch date and arrival date. So you can imagine that each point on this graph would reflect a trajectory from Earth to Mars. And so we had certain constraints. We knew that we wanted to use Delta launch vehicles, but that we couldn't use the same launch vehicle to do both missions. So one of them was going to be a Delta 7925, and the other one was going to be a heavy version of that same launch vehicle. We had to separate the two launch periods. And by launch period, I mean something on the order of 18 to 20 days that you can launch. The reason for doing this is that you can always have the possibility of launch delays due to weather, due to problems with the spacecraft, or due to problems with the rocket. I mean, I could say, okay, I want to launch right here. Okay, there's one day out of the year that I could launch that. That's great. But if some guy decides to go fishing in the range safety area, you're not going to launch that thing. That has happened. So there are other constraints. We wanted to make sure that this would be fully visible from Earth during our entry, descent, and landing. So we had elevation constraints of the Earth. We have the launch energy, and we also have arrival energy. So we had to juggle a lot of different things. One thing we also wanted to do was make sure there was enough separation between the launch of Spirit and the launch of Opportunity, so that the same crew could do both at the Kennedy Space at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. And we also wanted to have enough separation at arrival. The whole idea here was to improve our chances of success as much as possible. So Spirit comes in and lands. If something goes wrong, we want enough time to be able to analyze what happened, diagnose what happened, come up with some sort of corrective action, namely software, and send it up after testing. So we wanted to make sure we had at least 21 days between the arrival of Spirit and the arrival of Opportunity. So I got this chart from Ralph Moncoli at JPL. And I was looking at it, I said, why did we launch up here? We're still within all the limits. And it turns out, and that would have been great from an EDL reconstruction standpoint. Problem was, the project wanted Opportunity, or MER-B as it was called, to have better solar angles during its 90-day mission. Who knew it was going to last 13 years? If they'd known that, they might have done something a little different. So, where do you land on Mars? There is an intensive effort, as there always is during missions like this, to figure out the best places to land. My contribution to this was this oval. This was my estimate of what the landing footprint was, based on some analyses that I'll talk about more in a moment. But scientists developed a number of landing site workshops. They were looking at the most scientifically interesting places to land that were consistent with our constraints. And our constraints were not only the footprint, but also elevation. It had to be low enough so that this whole thing would be able to land successfully. Well, Gusev wound up being the landing site, preferred landing site for Spirit. Here's a perspective view of Gusev. It was at a low elevation, and there was this big channel right here. It's actually coming out of the south. And it was felt that that might have been an inflow channel, and that Gusev might have been a lake in the ancient past. What the scientists would do is they would take the ellipse, and they would move it around, try and find something that was consistent with our spacecraft and also scientifically interesting. And so this was the spot located for Gusev. For Opportunity, a different site was located. It was called Meridiani because it's right on the meridian. It's almost at 0 degrees longitude and about 2 degrees minus latitude. And the reason Ridiani was so interesting was because it had a lot of hematite. This was a mineral that forms in a variety of ways, the majority of which involved the presence of water. So it was felt that we had an opportunity for finding an environment that might have had a lot of water in Mars' ancient past. It was interesting to see the maps of hematite created by the orbiters. This area, it just stood out. It glowed in this one particular mineral.
What's the length of that ellipse, that footprint?
This footprint is about 45 miles long. So the idea, so it's kind of like finding a safe place to land in an area between here and, modeling landing uncertainty. A lot of things go into this. Basically, the way this works is the navigation team would give us, myself and Prayson Desai, who's doing parallel analyses at Langley Research Center, NASA Langley. They would give us 2,000 entry states, and we would propagate them down to the surface, varying statistically a variety of models. One of them was the uncertainty in the atmosphere, and that was the biggest contribution to the length of this footprint. Another thing is that we don't know the spacecraft aerodynamics perfectly. We don't know its lift coefficient, its drag coefficient perfectly. So that was one of the main contributions to the width of the ellipse. Navigation uncertainty, winds, other things were all part of this. And as an engineer, I wasn't satisfied with just taking that and living with it. I wanted to have margins on our ellipse to take into account unknown unknowns. One of the things that we did for this mission, which I was particularly happy about, was that we had a probabilistic approach to modeling landing success. So Prayson and I would come up with our ellipses, margined and unmargined, and then we would apply it to this hazard map, which divided up the area, in this case the Gusev crater, into four different areas. The green were cratered plains and had a 97.6% chance of success of our landing system based on things like rock distribution, rock size, slopes, things like that. Yellow is heavily cratered plains with a similar success rate. Orange is worse. Red, you don't want to go there. So we could actually take this ellipse, and using this analysis, we could come up with contours of successful landing probabilities. This was useful because we could decide whether or not to do a maneuver. If we're landing somewhere here, we don't have to necessarily correct things to go back to our first aim point. So this was something new. In previous missions, it was a lot more ad hoc, a lot more less quantitative. So there were a lot of challenges associated with the development of this mission. One was just packing for this trip. We had to pack what wound up being 45% more mass into the same volume we used for Pathfinder. The back shell and heat shield were the same dimensions, but we had a lot more mass to put into it. Another challenge was the parachute, which also had to be larger and heavier. Initial test results were not terribly encouraging. What they did was they took the test articles and they attached them to a weight, threw them out of an airplane, and they were invariably torn to shreds. And the problem was they just couldn't control the conditions under which the parachute was deploying. So instead, they went to the Ames Research Center, the world's largest wind tunnel, and tested it there. And the thing is, you can rev this up to about 70 miles an hour, I think it was, and you get the same force on the parachute that you would get high up in the Martian atmosphere going at supersonic speed. So, what I'm trying to do is run this video. This gives you an idea of what it looks like on the inside. I once went into this and there was an entire airplane inside the test section. This was a much more satisfactory way of doing these tests. You notice how it opens up, and it opens up just partially first? You'll see it again here. See this sort of, it's called squidding in the parachute world. And the first time they did this test, it never stopped squidding. It just looked like that forever. And it never opened fully. So what they had to do was they had to change the size of the vent hole. This is called a disc gap band parachute, and it's the same type that was used for Viking and with different design parameters used for the Apollo missions. This gives you an idea of the size of this parachute. It is absolutely enormous. I actually took these two pictures. I had an opportunity to witness one of these tests, and it was quite a thing to see. This is one of the turbines that operates the wind tunnel. The blades are actually wooden. So that was one challenge. Another challenge is the airbags. And I'm just going to run this little video. But before I do, the idea was to use actually a spare set of airbags that had been developed for Pathfinder. So they put the test article inside this airbag, and they went to the world's largest vacuum chamber in, I believe it's in Cleveland, and they dropped it, and it tore a hole in the airbags. It was bad. So they figured, well, maybe it was just because they were old. And so they redid the test, tore another hole in the airbags. So these airbags are very complicated devices. They're multi-layered, multi-load. They vent from one chamber into another. They have to inflate quickly. They have to be able to be deflated and retracted. They're everything as complicated as any rocket. And this just shows some work that was done on a subsequent test.
The outermost layer gets a really, really big scar on it. It's torn back in a major fashion. But the next layer down is protected by the fact that this is basically buffering the rock, keeping the sharp edges covered over, and protecting this falling layer.
Call that the anchor point. There's an anchor point over here. It reaches over and grabs that point. So for any anchor point,
go lateral on that and see how the large motion is accommodated. Not out of the plane, but in plane.
Gives you an idea of the size.
You know, if you back up a little bit, you can actually see an abrasion layer lifted off.
You can actually see, what, two tears of the abrasion?
I've never seen it stay inflated that long. I mean, it was almost like there's, it was fully inflated for 5 minutes afterwards. That's what.
So, by the way, those rocks were different colors, so you could tell where it landed and which ones did the damage. Another challenge was winds. This is something that came to our realization late in the game. When Pathfinder landed, it landed essentially in the early morning. We were landing in the afternoon. And what that meant was that as a result of the timing and also where we were landing, we could expect higher winds to occur at our landing site than Pathfinder did. So the concern here was that high winds could do two things. It's going to move it across the surface of Mars, and it could also interact with the dynamics of the vehicle so that at rad firing it could actually make it increase the horizontal velocity. And so the airbags could scrape along the ground possibly failing, because what you want is you want the airbags to drop down vertically if possible and not scrape. So late in the game, we added a new rocket system to null out the horizontal velocity. It's called the transverse impulse rocket system. And in order to do that, we also needed something to sense this motion. We had a radar altimeter, which could tell us the vertical component of our, how high we were above the ground, but it wouldn't say anything about how fast we were going laterally. And so, a descent camera was added to sense this motion. And this was something that we really didn't want to do as late in the game as we did, but it was wound up to be useful. This is a little simulation that was done at Langley. So watch this area here. See that blue thing? That was a transverse rocket firing and compensating for the horizontal velocity. Another challenge, of course, was roving. And you have a challenge starting almost immediately. You land this thing, you have to get off the platform to get on Mars and to do what you need to do. I'm going to run these simultaneously, and it'll show you some of the egress tests that were used. As you can see, this was for one height of the platform above the ground. This was a much larger one, and this was final, one of the later egress tests.
Currently on egress test number 202, coming off a 27 centimeter deck height with no egress aim, using a new egress rover, coming below you first. Wire display. You don't need them.
So that worked pretty well.
Egress test number 235, coming off 64 centimeter deck height, and number 3 egress aim, coming off that one, number 2. Bogey first.
This one, not so much, huh? Okay. And obviously you're not going to have an engineer waiting to write it if you run Mars. What they decided to do to help things out was to add this sort of egress aid. It was a sort of a fabric thing between the pedals, which you see right here, that would ease the transition to the surface. And it says 2 days into a 17-day launch period. It's a little deceiving. There was actually a period of about a week where the Spirit spacecraft was delayed in getting to be installed on the rocket. And there was feared to be a problem with the test pyros that were used. They were afraid that it might have damaged the electronics on the spacecraft. So a frantic search ensued for finding the test articles, and they were tested and everything was fine, but this did delay things. I think there was another weather delay too. I got a chance to see the Spirit launch beautifully, no problems at all. Opportunity launched on July 7, and it was 14 days to its 21-day launch period. There were a number of problems with the rocket and with weather. So once again, this shows the importance of having a nice long launch period that you can utilize. So now we have the spacecraft in interplanetary space. It's getting ready to go to Mars. During cruise, we had a number of trajectory correction maneuvers that we were planning for. Here's something you may not know. When a launch vehicle launches to Mars, the upper stage is not aimed directly at the aim point that would take it to Mars. And the reason is that we don't want that upper stage impacting Mars. The U.S. is a signatory to international planetary protection requirements that mean that we're going to do everything we can to avoid having an unsterilized upper stage impact Mars and possibly contaminate whatever ecosystem might exist. So, one thing that happens shortly after launch is that the spacecraft has to correct for this bias. And so that's what TCM-1 is, and it's always a rather large maneuver. We then shape the trajectory throughout cruise until we get to Mars, and we get right to the aim point that we need and the entry angle limits that we need too. So as you can see, January was a very busy time. One of the things that I was doing during this time was I was doing a lot of Monte Carlo analyses. Every time a maneuver was made, I would take those states and run it down and see whether we were within our necessary limits for entry, descent, and landing. So, entry, descent, and landing is, I want you to think of it as a lot like launch, okay? For launch, you take something at rest with respect to the Earth, and you add a lot of energy to it until finally you're going thousands of miles an hour and you're going off into interplanetary space. In this case, you're coming screaming in at about 5 kilometers per second, and now you have to kill off all that energy until you come to rest on the surface of Mars. A lot has to happen in these 6 minutes. It was 6 minutes of terror for us. For Curiosity, it was 7 minutes. But we had to do it twice. So for us, it was 12 minutes. As the animation showed, you have cruise stage separation. You have entry and peak heating, parachute deployment, heat shield separation, lander separation, bridle descent. The radar has to acquire the ground. The descent imager has to work. Airbags have to inflate. The rockets have to fire, and you have to cut the bridle. All this has to happen in a very short period of time, and it has to be done without intervention from the ground. And the reason is, this whole thing takes 6 minutes, but our one-way light time delay is 9 or 10 minutes. So let's say we're looking at this, and we say, good grief, the parachute hasn't deployed. I press the button for deploying the parachute, it's gonna be way too late, because it's gonna take 9 or 10 minutes for that signal to reach the spacecraft. That's why entry, descent, and landing is such a nail-biting experience. All you can do is monitor what's going on and hope that a mistake made a week ago or a year ago won't kill the mission. We had a lot of, we applied a lot of importance to having a communication throughout the entry, descent, and landing phase. That's one thing we didn't have during Mars Polar Lander, and it was very frustrating. We knew that Mars Polar Lander turned to the entry attitude, and we lost communication at that point, as was our design, and we never heard from it again. So what exactly happened? It was hard to reconstruct what happened. This time, we wanted to make sure we could see every phase of entry, descent, and landing. And we had direct-to-Earth communications, and we had UHF communication to the Mars Global Surveyor, which was positioned to support entry, descent, and landing as well. So on January 4th, 2004, Spirit lands. And only 4 trajectory correction maneuvers were required to land Spirit within 6 miles of the target. There's our target, there's where we landed. So everyone was very happy, obviously, that this landed successfully, although there was some nail biting even after landing. It took a few minutes for the lander to send back a signal that indicated that it was safe. And this was something that, I don't know, it was kind of funny thing about Spirit. Spirit was always the problem child. Opportunity worked great all the time, but Spirit was always a problem. So this is what Spirit's landing site looked like. And frankly, it was a little bit of a disappointment. It looked a lot like the Viking landing site, looked a lot like the Pathfinder landing site. Lava, rocks, dirt. But that's one nice thing about a rover program. If you don't like where you are now, you can go somewhere else. It's more interesting. What followed then were the busiest 3 weeks of my life. Spirit lands, and now, 21 days later, Opportunity lands. There's no way we can delay it. It's going to happen. It's a matter of physics. It's going to be coming in on January 25th, whether we like it or not, and whether we're ready for it or not. So the 21 days between Spirit landing and Opportunity landing were used to perform a rapid reconstruction of entry, descent, and landing. And it occurred to me when I was making this presentation that no one had ever been asked to do something like this. Even for Viking, they were in orbit. If they needed more time, they could have just waited to deploy Viking 2. And in fact, I think it was a 40-day interval between landing Viking 1 and landing Viking 2. So we were doing something that hadn't been done before. We really had to understand what happened to Spirit and how close to failing we were. And any software changes would need to be tested thoroughly before uploading to the spacecraft. The project manager says, okay, it'll take a week to do reconstruction, and it'll take another week to figure out what to do and come up with a new sequence and test it, another week to put it up on the spacecraft. So I tell you, we could have used a little more time than that. What happened was, bridal deploy took longer than expected. And so it was decided to pop the parachute earlier to give us timeline margin. One of the things I was responsible for was developing, along with a lot of very talented people, the parachute deploy algorithm for the spacecraft. It's kind of interesting that in the early days of the project, we were worried about the strength of the parachute. So we set a dynamic pressure limit. And then before Spirit landed, we increased that. And then before Opportunity landed, we increased it again. So I tell you, during the Opportunity landing, there was a lot of nail biting going on. I mean, you have to think, it worked first time. Maybe we shouldn't fool around with it, you know? But a friend of mine, I was really nervous during the Spirit landing. A friend of mine, Rob Manning, was he was really nervous during Opportunity. This is one of my favorite pictures. This is Spirit leaves the nest. So the rover is taking a look at what brought it to Mars. And this was only a few days before Opportunity arrived. And once again, Spirit was kind of acting up. 18 days after Spirit landed, there was a problem. It wouldn't go to sleep. I guess it was too excited. And they had to do a lot of diagnosis and send up a software patch. It was potentially a very serious issue if they were able to take care of it. And all the time, Opportunity was coming in. On January 25th, Opportunity lands, and if my records are correct, it only took 3 trajectory correction maneuvers to land Opportunity within 15 miles of the target. So here's the target. Here's where we landed. When Opportunity landed, it bounced and rolled right into a crater. It was really a neat coincidence that it landed in this little crater right here. And you see this area here, these were rock outcroppings, actually bedrock that had been exposed by this ancient impact. And it was really interesting to see the pictures coming in from Opportunity, because they were like no other place on Mars. And the primary science investigator, the principal investigator, Steve Squires, predicted this. He said Meridiani was not going to look like anything else on Mars, and he was exactly right. So, for me, it was milling time. My job was done. Both rovers were on the surface and in one piece, and they were at the target site. But for the scientists and the drivers of the rovers, their missions were just beginning, and they could not have had any idea how long it was going to last. Both missions were designed to complete their science goals within 90 sols of landing. Spirit rode for 7 years. Opportunity is still going more than 13 years later. I have another presentation here that talks a little bit about the surface mission, if we have time for that. Is that all right? I know I'm a little over time. So here's some Spirit images. It was hard to know what to show, since there are like 100,000 images that have been sent down by the rovers over these years. Spirit, as I said, had problems, but it wound up going to some hills nearby. This was some layered terrain that always excites geologists. This is an interesting microscopic image of a piece of lava. I like this because it shows the rover tracks going off into the distance. Spirit had a lot of problems. Like I said, shortly after landing, there was no signal for 2 days. It wasn't sleeping properly, but they corrected it. In March 2006, troublesome front wheel stopped working entirely. The rover drivers found that driving backwards worked better. And remember, it had hazard cameras in the front and in the back, and it's a good thing they had them in the back. Because for the next 3 years, they were driving this rover backwards, okay? The stuck wheel dug trenches in the earth as it was moving along, which led inadvertently to the discovery, See this white patch right here? The soil was similar to some of that found at hot springs on Earth. So it's an ill wind that doesn't blow somebody some good. The stuck wheel actually led to a scientific discovery. Power was a problem for both rovers at different points, especially during and after dust storms and during winter. A rover controller sometimes had to keep Spirit stationary for months at a time to make sure the solar arrays were tilted in a favorable direction, kind of towards the sun. The only way to do that is to tilt the whole spacecraft. So they'd find a hill and go up that hill, and it would help Spirit last through the winter. So in May of 2009, the rover got stuck in soft soil and got hung up on a rock. Okay, the wheels are almost completely buried. It didn't look like a challenging rove. I mean, it looked like fine footing, as it were, but it wound up being sort of a crust, and underneath was very fine soil. And it wound up on top of this little rock here. This is a picture from the microscopic imager, which was the only way they could look underneath the rover, okay? They had hazard cameras pointing fore and aft, but nothing they could see underneath. So they took this microscopic imager and looked between its legs. That's why it's out of focus. So there was, as you can imagine, a lot of work done in the test bed to try and figure out what to do, but all attempts to move it failed, and eventually another wheel failed. So Spirit stopped roving at that point, became stationary lander.
When the solar panels covered with dust, is that why you lost power? I mean, if you cover solar panels with dust, it's not gonna, it's good.
Let me answer that with the next slide, okay. But basically what happened was the solar arrays were at an unfavorable angle, and eventually there just wasn't enough energy. The combination of dust and low solar angles just meant that there wasn't enough to operate the rover. And on March 22nd, we had the last communication from the rover. This is Spirit's Trek. Actually, it's the next slide that I'll show you. As you can see, this is a 500 meter bar. It wound up going, I think, about 7 kilometers or so. And it did a lot of good work. Dust on the solar panels. That was definitely a problem. But fortunately, we inadvertently, we had a solution to it in the dust devils and winds. This is a sort of GIF animation that shows dust devils going across the surface of Mars. At one point, Spirit was getting about 60% of its expected power input. And then suddenly it went to almost 100%. And what happened was a dust devil came along and did this, completely cleaned off the solar rays. Now that's what I call a break. Here's some images from Opportunity. I like that one. As you can see, there are a lot of dunes that it had to roll across. It saw cliffs, hills, and outcroppings from craters. And it even went and took a look at its old heat shield, which is still on the surface, obviously. Here are some science results, which you have to take with a grain of sand because I'm not a scientist, I'm an engineer. But one of the things that was discovered were blueberries, as they were called, little tiny spherules that contain a lot of hematite. They might have been formed by underground acidic water. The bright soil I already talked about indicated possibly highly salted water, possibly an ancient hydrothermal system. One thing that the geologists were particularly interested in, fascinated by, was the discovery of clays. I don't know about you, I'm not fascinated by clays, but they are very important because they're indicative of neutral pH water, something you could drink, something that would be more conducive to the rise of life. Ripples in some rocks probably were caused by slow-moving water, so this area, especially Meridiani, might have sort of hosted a very shallow sort of, if you want to call it an ocean, that might have been highly acidic or salty in its contents. So all this tended to support the hypothesis that an ancient Mars was wetter and had a thicker atmosphere. Opportunity, just a year ago, I think, won the off-world roving record previously held by the Soviet Knocke rover on the moon. And I just wanted to show this to you. This is Marathon by Opportunity, 26.2 miles and 11 years and 2 minutes. And I think this is a time when I can entertain any questions. Yes?
Is there any possibility for Spirit to get moved by the road so that it would start up again?
I don't think so. They spent a lot of time trying to reestablish contact, and they even were hoping that when spring and summer came that it might revive itself, but it never did. So it's dead, Jim. That's a Star Trek tip.
When you said you both of them missed their targets, did it overshoot them or undershoot the target?
Well, they both overshooted the target, which was not in itself a concern. It suggested that our atmospheric models were a little too, our atmospheric profiles were a little higher in density than they should have been. What was interesting to me was that they both wound up on the very edge of the 99% ellipse. And I don't have a good answer for that. That is something that I've always wondered about, but it was I always considered it a good argument for putting a little margin on your calculations to account for unknown unknowns. Yes?
Earlier you were talking about the horizontal trajectory caused by the winds.
Yeah.
Were you guys able to gather data from the lander to indicate that you did experience those winds at all and what speed those winds were at?
When the reconstruction was done for Opportunity, one of the engineers looked at it and said, good grief, it looks like we actually needed this. So the reconstruction, they were able to tell what the horizontal velocity was by taking a look at the descent images. Yes?
I don't understand if the density of the atmosphere on Mars is, what do you say, like 1% of the Earth's? Mm-hmm. I don't understand how a parachute of that size would even have any effect on slowing it down, and I don't understand how a heat shield could generate so much heat with that going on. And like high winds on Mars, looks like it would have very little effect, you know, like trying to walk in high winds here because of low density.
Well, that, okay, first of all, the reason that the heat shield was required was because we were coming in at very high speeds. 5 kilometers per second, you know, you're generating a lot of pulse friction.
How much heat would be generated like compared to Apollo coming back to Earth?
I never made that comparison, but it would not be as much. Obviously the more dense atmosphere of Earth is going to be a bigger problem. As far as the parachute, there was enough atmosphere to use a large parachute to slow us down. You still have drag that you're going to develop. I don't know what to say. It all works out. We still use a parachute in order to slow down, and the whole thing is on the parachute for a fair amount of time that allows the winds to eventually drag it across.
Like if you were out in a 50-mile-an-hour wind on Mars and 50-mile-an-hour wind on here, you would feel a lot more pressure blowing against you here, though, than you would on Mars.
Yes, yes, you would. And that was one problem I had with the movie The Martian, if you remember. the dust storm that they were talking about would never have the effects that they show there. Despite the smaller density, despite the smaller pressure, all of these effects did in fact occur. Yes?
How much did the parachute change the velocity by percentage-wise?
It changed it significantly. I think I have something that would actually include that. Let's see. So at parachute deployment, you're going about 430 meters per second. And at rocket firing, you're going about 75 meters per second.
Wow.
So it does slow down. Yes?
During all your timeline between chute deployment and the rockets firing, mm-hmm. You have times where I do this now. But if for some reason there's a failure, is there a timeline? I'm going to go ahead and do this now?
Yeah. We had backup times. And one of the things that we would do is we would take the entry states, run them down another, you know, 2,000 times. I got to say that by the time we actually landed, we had landed this thing hundreds of thousands of times. But we had an opportunity for a final parameter update. And one of those things was backup timers for things like the parachute and other events.
So regardless, during that, the parachute will deploy?
Yes, it will, but
whether you're on time or not,
your success rates were necessarily quite a bit lower. But yeah, we had that, and we kept a close look on the parameters. Yeah.
Why were the rovers only planned or expected to go for only 19 sols?
You have to have some planning horizon. Mm-hmm. It seems to be an axiom of space exploration that if the thing doesn't fail right away or wind up at the bottom of the ocean, it'll last forever. And unless there's some other physical mechanism that would prevent it from lasting longer. An example is Phoenix, okay, which landed near the North Pole of Mars. Angles, sun angles, we knew eventually would get low enough so that there just wouldn't be enough solar energy. But for anything else, there's nothing specific that would cause a failure. I mean, eventually something will happen. But it was believed that with these instruments, with these rovers, at these landing sites, that we could get a very good science mission done in 90 sols. And so that was the planning horizon.
Which leads to the next question. After 6 years or 12 years, what more is there to find that isn't what you've already found? It's like, look at these rocks, these rocks are the same, these rocks are the same, these rocks are only slightly different. Well, I mean, after a while, don't you kind of exhaust the newness of what you can discover?
I suppose that might happen, but they keep making these discoveries, and it's interesting. One of the things that I remember from Mars Polar Lander was that geologists really like to go to places that have different, they're sort of contact sites, okay? They have different geologies in close proximity, and that seems to be what's happening here. We're going from one place to another and discovering new things. Now, at some point, I don't know if they're going to decide to turn it off. Voyagers have been going since 1976, and they're still gathering data outside the solar system.
We have to see what's going on way out there. You got to see.
But you have to appreciate that it is you're going to be loath to turn off an asset which is already there, which is why they go on with more and more extended missions.
So with all of this planning and stuff, so you must be a real treat to go on a trip. I mean, you must have it all laid out ahead of time. Melody knows that at this time this is going to happen, that time that's going
to
happen.
I'm kind of addicted to spreadsheets.
Yeah. Well, I'm still figuring out how we can make that work so you get me to implant something so you can say, now, Susie, you're supposed to be over here. Well, if there are any more questions, I think Bill would hang around a little bit. Be sure and look at the pictures that they provided him when he did retire. They're fantastic pictures. And again, thank you so much for coming and telling us.